Let's call the meeting to order at 4:00 of the Board of Water and Sewer Commissioners. First on the agenda, do I have a vote to waive the reading of the minutes of the October 19th meeting?
Make a motion to waive the meeting of minutes from October 19th.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call vote.
Bednarik, aye.
Catron, aye.
O'Brien, aye. That's it. Okay. We're in the midst of signing bills. Any questions on the bills? New business, we're going to consider the appointment of Justin Kudo of 2341 County Street, Somerset, for the sewer technician at the sewer department. Harry?
Control department.
Sorry, Harry, I rushed it. Sorry.
That's okay.
Anything that you want to say? I know you guys did the interviews.
Myself, the superintendent, and maintenance supervisor did interviews. We interviewed four employees, and Justin Kudo.
Yeah, we're going to do one at a time for that.
Yeah. Last week, I gave him a tour at a wastewater treatment plant and the pump station. We went to one pump station, and everything went very well, and he wants to continue with the next step.
Okay.
So the next step is to schedule physical, Corey check, and we're looking. I told him a start date would probably be early next year.
Okay.
Okay, by the time we get everything situated and stuff like that.
Great. So can I have a motion for Justin Kudo?
I make a motion to appoint Justin Kudo of 2341 County Street as the newest Somerset sewer technician.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Roll call vote.
Bednarik, aye.
Catron, aye.
O'Brien. So that's one. Consider the appointment for Michael Kamara of 1700 County Street, Somerset, sewer technician at the sewer department. Harry?
Yep, similar thing. We did the interviews, and part of the interview process is to give the candidate a tour of the wastewater treatment plant, which we did along with the pump stations, and we had a successful tour, and that was taking place yesterday, matter of fact. So
okay.
He's on board also, and I told him a similar thing of
after
the first of the year.
Awesome.
But same thing with physicals and Corey checks.
Awesome. Okay, can I have a motion to appoint Michael Kamara?
Make a motion to appoint Michael Kamara of 1700 County Street as the newest Somerset sewer technician.
Second?
Second.
Okay, roll call vote.
Bednarik, aye.
Catron, aye.
O'Brien, aye. So what we'll do is once they're employed, we'll bring them in. I just want to give them the hopes and dreams and what we expect out of them.
Absolutely.
Okay, so let's go into abatements. So let's start off with, we only have one anyway. So this is going to be for 353 Highview Avenue, Somerset. So you guys have the data sheet in front of you?
Yes.
So it's the same thing. They had a pretty significant leak.
Wow.
Carried over, we got it. Yeah. So it actually carried over from the one billing cycle to the other billing cycle. So on one, we're going to abate the water as per policy, and then the second one, we're going to abate the sewer. So the total comes out to $695.50. I'm sure it was explained to him about it being a one-time deal. So I'll have to make sure that's brought to their attention.
That's policy of the department, that it's a one-time, lifetime deal for an abatement.
Yep. So, do I have a motion to do the abatement of?
Make a motion to consider the abatement of 353 Highland Avenue, Somerset.
No, Highview Avenue.
Sorry, Highview Avenue.
Yeah, Andy Primo.
Andy Primo.
Yeah, $695.50.
In the amount of $695.95.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call vote.
Bednarik, aye.
Catron, aye.
O'Brien, aye. So that's the standard procedure. Done. Next, consider recommendation for Wright Pierce Design Phase Engineering Services for awarding the bid for the tank improvements at the hot and cold lane in the deep end tanks. So go ahead, all yours, bro. You want to explain it or? Pretty open to chat, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I knew you were here for a reason, Greg.
Yes, yeah.
Okay.
So as you guys know, the disinfection byproduct, part of that, order was to install that aeration system over in our storage tanks. So the end tanks, which is the, they buy them out, Nat Gun? So the company that actually constructed the tanks, Nat Gun Tanks, is now DN Tanks. So they were the only bidder on this project, which is good because it is a pre-stressed concrete tank, as you guys know. So that takes a very specialized trade when you're gonna talk about locking holes in that thing, so. But the engineers are very happy with the proposal. It was actually underestimated value. I don't know if you guys saw the letter they sent?
Yeah.
So I don't see any issues with it whatsoever.
I just hope they don't decide to put baseball emblems on the tank while they're working on it. That was a triggering to the board.
We did have that conversation.
Did you hear what happened with that? When they built the tanks, they actually did a hydro, they took the power gun and they put a big Yankee sign on the whole tank. It must have been...
Oh, it's huge. It's got to be 60 feet, or the tanks are 80. It had to be 45 feet tall.
I drove by it and I saw the Yankees. And I'm like, oh my God, they painted the Yankee symbols on the tank.
No. We have a picture of it.
It was incredible.
Really?
Yeah, it was incredible. Anyway, okay, so...
Make a motion to approve the TTHM removal project 7134 contract in the amount of $1,174,800 to, what was the name of the company again?
DN Tanks.
To DN Tanks in Wakefield.
And about a second?
Second.
Okay, we'll go vote.
Bednarik aye.
Catterett aye.
O'Brien aye. Okay, when are they thinking?
Once he gets the letter of approval, they're going to do all the preliminary stuff, source the material. They said they expect probably late January, early February, because there's some electrical work that has to be done, some excavation work that has to be done, not just the tank mixing stuff.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Obviously, it's contingent on the three-phase being installed, so they got to coordinate with National Grid to make sure that gets, which is already, you know, in the queue, ready to rock and roll. So there's a little preliminary stuff, but of course that is... Right, required to be online by June 30th, I believe it is.
Yeah, that's 23.
So
that's what DEP.
They all know about that deadline, and you know they're gonna. And Mr. I don't know if Paul told you, but we notified Mr. McLaughlin.
Yeah, I saw. I was CC'd.
I saw the email.
Keep him in the loop.
Well, that's the best way to do it, right?
Absolutely.
We've been holding them off for quite a bit.
Absolutely.
They've been nothing but patient for us. So
yep.
That's good. Great. That's awesome. Okay. Let's go into our reports. Harry, you ready?
Sure.
I know we dropped the bomb on you.
No, that's...
Chris wants to stay with us a little while. So.
Of course he does. Current flows at the wastewater treatment plant are 3.6 million gallons.
They're climbing.
Yes, they are,
yes,
sir.
Yes, they are.
They are climbing, and some of the challenging, we're still working on our final clarifier with our engineering. So... it's been challenging because we're getting close. We should be operating two final clarifiers at this point. So, but today's rain was adding to the...
It was helpful.
It's making it a little more challenging with the process at this point in time. So we're dealing with that. Actually, Hart was on site today. They've had equipment delivered from R&S Rental to reassemble the clarifier. But it's a scheduling thing with Hart Engineering. This has been a fill-in type of job, but I did put a little more pressure on there, so we're hoping to get it done by Christmas at this point.
Wow,
so,
that's good.
But yeah.
That would relieve a little bit of stress.
That would leave, yes. Yes, as long as the weather cooperates with the rainfall down at the plant, we should be good. Other good news, a NPDES permit. We've met a NPDES permit, which is a final discharge to the Taunton River, so we're in compliance with that. If I go to operational issues, it's been a short week with the Thanksgiving holidays and stuff, but we had an issue at the Foley Avenue pump station. Guys were smelling gas inside the station.
Natural
gas. So we contacted the gas company, and things were moving a little slower, so we did the 911 call, got the fire department down there.
They came down and with their detectors, they could smell the gas, but they could not pick it up on the meters. I had my meter with me also, same thing, I couldn't pick it up, but you know, they did their whole entry procedures and stuff like that. Gas company ended up showing up, they tested outside.
Regulator?
Unit heaters inside the building. And so that's, I guess they weren't fully igniting the one on the top level and stuff. Most of the time, the VFDs throw enough heat off in that station for, you know, so we use minimal heat, but that was an issue where basically the heaters need to be serviced. So we contacted our local vendor that takes care of heating system down at the plant. So we're trying to schedule that to get them in and to check out all the other gas heaters at all the other stations, because it's something that needs to be taken care of.
The dampness. Yeah. The dampness.
Yeah, some of the, right, some of the flues, whatever, so the gas company tagged out those units, so we're not using them at all at this point. But it's still warm enough.
In case of an emergency, I can always volunteer my time.
Very good, appreciate that. So we still have some issues with Cinegrill of just scheduling and the incinerator where we dispose of a sludge over in Woonsocket, Rhode Island. Becomes challenging, but we're getting there. So it's either they got a problem at the incinerator. Last week they had a problem with their burner. Trucks get backlogged, so I usually miss like one load a week going out of there. Typically we do six, so I like to stay ahead of the curve and as best we can with the sludge disposal. Chlorine system, we just had to go through the whole CL17 chlorine system, replacing hoses. We're having issues that the chlorine wasn't maintaining the proper levels at the plant and stuff, but maintenance went through that, and the system seems to be working a lot better once we worked on that chlorine system. On a complaint department, we had on Route 6, I had Mass Highway come down to our facility complaining of manholes on Route 6 from basically the Swansea line to Brayton Point Road of deterioration around the asphalt.
So down near the beans?
Not so much the beans, I want to say between probably Lees River Avenue and Brayton Point or Horner Millworks.
The other side of the bridge, Ohio.
In the Horner Millworks area. So they took some pictures, I guess. You know, so they had a lot of complaints coming in from manhole deterioration with the asphalt and stuff like that. So speaking with Chris, he does a lot of water work, you know, on state highways to help us out get a permit. We're trying to coordinate that with Coastal. We contacted Coastal to see if they were interested. So
they're going to change the ring?
Not so much the ring, but just probably jackhammer it out around the structure. They might have to pour some concrete or whatever and replace the asphalt around the structures. So it's just, you know, water coming into the, you know, around the frames, the brickwork and stuff like that, breaking up the asphalt around the manholes. So it looks like at least four manholes to me would need immediate attention. The other ones, but I think we've got to start on that this fall of trying to get that corrected.
So that'll probably require state police, right?
That's a state permit, and so, you know, being after November 15th with, you know, with the cold weather coming in, there's certain things that have to take place with part of the permit process and stuff, so we'll work, hopefully get that done sooner than later on that, correct. Had a meeting today with Wright Pierce down at the plant on sludge pumping, winter emergency sludge pumping that we're trying to put a contract together. So we met with Hot Engineering, we met with Watermark Electric and Wright Pierce, and we, you know, put everything together, see how we could get this pipe in situation and pump replacement moving forward. So everybody seemed to be on board, and so.
Is Hartley, they can do it over the, yeah?
We're moving forward with that.
Wow.
The things you look at on that is we gotta replace the piston pumps, and the new pumps are gonna be at 10 weeks, so we're looking at late February, March, probably. But if they can at least start that job, demoing some of the equipment, laying out some of the piping ahead of time, that'd be great. So we're doing our best to, presently, we have a 6-inch diesel pump outside. We've been heat tracing that, trying to winterize that, trying to make quick connects so we can move that in and out of the building at this point in time. So far, things have worked out. You know, the cold weather's cooperating with us.
The weather's helping.
A little bit, but we know sooner or later it's going to be an issue.
You guys get any temporary heaters, like bullet heaters or something, you can put in just to keep it?
Yeah, we're thinking of that also.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. We're trying to come up with some sort of enclosure maybe at this point as a temporary situation also, Scott. So
you get yourself like a good, 200,000 BTU or even a 400,000.
We just got to be careful because you're talking sludge and the potential of gases.
Well, that's why I said the kerosene one versus the propane.
You just got to look at those issues, and we're looking into those issues also.
You could also look into what's the name? Scott, the RS rental has the ductless ones.
Okay.
You can remote the unit away,
and just
30 feet away. Then you just take the flex stuff and just bring it, and all that does is blow air.
Blow heated air.
So if you're
just
blowing air, that's certainly not going to have any combustible issues.
Right, right. So those are the things.
Where you can tent it off or whatever. I'm just saying. Because at this point, whatever it's got to be, it's got to be, because you certainly can't be without it. So,
yep, absolutely.
Maybe contact them. I mean, that's what they use in a lot of the construction buildings, the bigger buildings. So.
Right. It'll only be a temporary thing. I'm not sure if I talked last month. We ended up with a demand response check of $1,015.92. So,
Harry, where does that check go? Does that go into our account or into the general fund?
I don't know the answer on that. I know we used to put it towards our electrical bill, Joe, on that, but I'm not sure where that goes. Revenues, I'm not sure where that goes presently.
Good question.
I just wanted to make sure we're getting it in
pencil
our price fund.
We'll send Paul on that one.
Yeah.
Because okay. That's what it's going towards.
Okay.
What's that?
I believe I am all set, sir.
Okay, good job, Harry.
Oh, I'm sorry, I got one more thing.
And Beth, you ready to come out of the bullpen?
Yeah.
You're next.
We had a manhole cover at the intersection of Chase and County Street 138. Car hit it and flipped off the cover. Did damage to her car, and I believe the car behind her ended up getting towed. So that's been reported to our insurance company. Police were on site, and I believe we're still waiting for an accident report from them at this point in time. So I've spoken to one of the operators of the car. I also passed it on to the superintendent, and so I know our insurance company has been notified at this point.
What type of structure does the cover flip off of, or brand?
Of
manhole.
Was one of our old 24-inch covers, Joe.
Do we have a lot of those?
Oh, there's thousands of them in town. Yes. Yeah, that's our old standard manhole cover that ended up flipping on that. We are, as new developments come in, the 24 inches are now being replaced with the 30-inch covers, which is very heavy too. Take off and stuff like that, it's one of those things that sometimes you just hit it just right or it starts rocking, and
I was just curious if maybe we have to do like preventative maintenance of that style to make sure we don't have any more
that
is
the only one that I've ever
used
weld them or whatever. The only other time I ever seen it was up on Wilbur Avenue. We had an issue with one.
Okay.
It's not a common thing.
I know. Yeah, but they are getting older every day. They're in service,
right? So.
It's an oddball thing, boy.
It's a complete oddball. The flip.
It really is.
I'm not to lose the title. Yeah. All right, Beth, you're up.
Okay. plant flow for the water department at 1.8 million gallons per day average. Reservoir level is 95 inches below full, 40 inches lower in elevation than 2021. The mid-level intake is 228 inches below full. And for the office, the lien process is in progress. As of tomorrow, December 8th, any past due amount that was due as of June 30th of 2022 will be added to the fiscal year 23 actual real estate tax bill. So that'll be going over to town hall tomorrow. And the second thing is our new clerk started work November 28th of 2022 and is going well with his training.
Yeah, how's he doing? Good?
Good, very good.
Mm-hmm. The good day about it, he's got training from before.
So right, correct. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's it.
And that's it.
Thanks,
for the office.
That's beautiful. Guess who's up?
Lucky me.
Lucky you.
Lucky me. We touched base on the hot and cold tank mixing project, so no other questions on that, I assume. Period two, lead and copper samples, the required samples. We out of the 60 that we're required to do, we got one left to do. Of course, there's always one in the bin that is difficult to get, you know, because it's all homeowner response. We are chasing that one. You know, we have to the end of the month to collect that sample, so we will probably have to get an alternate, you know, if we can't, if all our measures fail, of trying to get in contact with that homeowner.
After this testing period, is that going to shrink down now? Is that gonna
so hopefully, he's been in touch with the DEP. If we are in compliance, which at this point we are, and even if that one last sample fails, we'll still be in compliance, we can apply for reduced monitoring. I believe it is 30, right now it's 60 samples twice a year. I think they reduce you down to 30 samples twice a year. And then if you're a good doobie with that, then they, I don't know if they still do the every 3 years thing. I'm not 100% sure if they do that, but hopefully it will be reduced.
Well, 30, 60 to 30 is going to be big.
Yes, because it is extremely labor intensive. It is expensive. And, you know, we have been very successful at complying with that regulation. So that's a good thing. Yeah, as you guys know, we do the school samples also as part of this program. One of the schools did come back a little elevated, so 15 parts per billion is the action level. This came back at 17 parts per billion, so although in exceedance.
Per billion.
15,
so
yes.
I understand that.
Yes, 17 parts per billion. So a very small amount, but it was in exceedance of the action level. So we notified the school department. Basically, they take that service tap out of service, either replace it or they'll do some modifications. So there's a whole protocol from the DEP that they'll have to go through to rectify that situation.
Do we know where they drew that from?
It was a kitchen. It was I don't think they prepare food there, but I think it was like a kitchen sink that they use for washing, you know, whatever they do for food preparation.
A lot of that stuff. I think it's a lot stagnant now because they don't.
Yes, because so that is a concern with this. You know, with this program. You know, it was. You know, created back when a majority of these schools had their own cafeterias in them. Obviously, a lot of this is now shifted to, you know, they transport the food in, don't have these facilities as, you know, they don't use them in the capacity that they were designed. So, you know, you do have static water and all that. Of course, you know, the recommendation is always to run the cold water faucet, you know, for a short amount of time before any water consumption, especially in schools, because obviously the DEP's goal is zero. Detectable lead in any of the schools or early childhood care facilities. So, you know, that's the goal.
Yeah,
so
just so that you know, so to explain that just a little bit more, it comes from the brass faucet.
Oh, absolutely. So, for comparison's sake, the second sample we collected at the same school came back non-detectable or below detectable limits from the lab. So we do a source water sample here, an effluent sample. That came back below detectable limits. So
I just want people not to think that they have lead pipes in the school.
Right. 99% of the detections are from within the dwelling or the building itself through, you know, lead-based solder, through lead, you know, brass, those types of things.
Yep. And especially if it's staggering.
Yes, and particularly if it's staggering. And as you guys know, we basically mimic worst-case scenario. Within the sampling protocol, right? Because the water is required to be stagnant for 6 hours or longer. First draw sample, so no running the water, no nothing. It's as if you were to put your cup underneath the faucet, take the first drop of water that comes out of that faucet and consume it. So But they have been, the school has been very responsive and they're rectifying that situation. The Segregance Pump Station is currently operating, so tis the season.
Yay.
The tide is slowly rising in the reservoir, so that will run until, you know, if the, this time of year, it's kind of on and off again, depending on the river flows up there. But we are slowly on the recovery, as you saw from the reservoir level, we've already gained, I don't know, maybe 8 or 10 inches, so that's good. Hopefully the stream flows continue and we'll keep pumping.
Well, it just rains not.
Yeah, so it's essentially a little more than an inch. We can gain a little more than an inch a day, and you know, between the water we take out for, you know, processing, mm-hmm. and the water we put in, we gain about an inch a day. So we got a good 3 months of pumping to do to fill that reservoir back up to its full level. So plus whatever we might get from the natural watershed up there. The Almy Road culvert project up there, you guys know about the 20-inch water main, one of the water mains within that scope of that project. So we've had discussions with the contractor and the engineer. They basically repaired the existing 20-inch water main that we talked about, encased it in concrete. One of the issues up there is the elevation of that existing water pipe. To relocate that is extremely expensive and extremely challenging because it is a transmission main, right? That's the water main leaving from here up to the water storage tanks. So what the engineers decided to do is they'll encase that repair, made the repair, they encase it in concrete, but they will install a section of 20-inch pipe on the side of it, new, right? And then at some date in the future, we will connect, we'll abandon the original 20-inch that has the repair to it and hook up to under the culvert. So that was the compromise for that issue up there with the 20-inch. So that's another project we'll have to, you're probably best to fold it into another, you know, piping project that we'll be involved with, you know. So that's the story with that. The water meter program, as you know, it continues where I think, Beth, what was the number? Less than 200, about 200 left?
I believe so.
Somewhere in the neighborhood, about 200 meters left to replace. You know, these are the homeowners that flat out refuse, need repairs. You know, they may be, seasonal residents, that type of thing. So we're trying our best to get those to change, get those meters changed, because obviously we're not gonna see the full benefit of this investment from the new water meters until we get basically every meter done.
Yeah, we're gonna have to be a little bit more assertive.
So we're gonna have to, yes, consider, you know, either increasing that non-standard meter fee is a big one, right? That really gets people's attention, you know what I mean? Or you're gonna have to come up with a moratorium to get that last bit complete.
Figure a way to implement that service repair somehow into their billing or whatever.
Yeah, because it does get extremely labor intensive because we still have to maintain the old reading system, right? We still got to pay for all that, right? We're running two systems now,
right?
Because
it's
we're kind of
purpose.
And it defeats the purpose of having, you know, the more modern.
Plus, you know, the funny thing is that people don't realize that what it's all about. It's not just reading the meters. It's when you have someone like this person.
Oh, absolutely! Yes, yeah. So the analytics that are now available
at any given moment,
discrepancies or anything.
We can see what their total usage is. We can see. We'll try to find a graph.
It's for everybody's benefit, yes. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, but if there's a leak, you can find it. Just have a graph on it. You know, where it shows the high-low flows. It's just important, and there's a reason why we did it. The reason
yeah.
why we spent all that money is to make sure that we weren't going to have these issues.
Yep. So something we got to keep our focus on.
Like this. So that's George. Turn it over this way, just like so someone can see that. So that graph shows you when this person had their leak. They can see how it just peaked right up, and then we were able to pick that up, and which we could notify someone if they had a potential big leak.
Mm-hmm.
So
or
there's
irrigation
a lot of, there's,
or any
there's
other.
A lot of advantages to
yep.
the town residents for doing that.
Yes.
So it's kind of crazy
yep.
that they're not. It is what it is.
Our hydrant assessment program that we are working collaboratively with the fire department. We're still going, hopefully we can get to at least the end of the year with that. So as you know, we got about 850 hydrants in town. We've up to about 250 have been assessed, right? So that's us, also the fire department going there, you know, making sure the caps come off, make sure that, you know, there's no, yeah, they've really,
really
good,
yeah.
Wow.
You know, so we're about quarter of the way done. Mm-hmm. You know, so we just confirm that the hydrant works or doesn't work or no any deficiencies. Right about now, we're experiencing about a 7 to 10% failure rate. So we got about 50. We found about 15 hydrants that are out of service because of, you know, they're either non-repairable or they're, you know, we've replaced 7 of those 15.
Are we doing that in-house?
We will be, yes, we do the replacements in-house. Of course, as you guys know, we didn't have the opportunity to budget for, I mean, this is, so right now the water department has just under $50,000 expended in labor and parts for up to date, you know, so we're going to have to
fund it
quite more. Paul did mention he did get some grant money. I'm not sure on the total amount, so that will be a huge benefit fiscal 24 going forward, you know. So, but the fire department has been a big help with this. So, you know, I think it's a very good thing, you know, and whatever deficiencies are found are there, right? And now is when we want to find them. We don't want to find them when the hydrant is
when there's a fire.
Yeah. And it's great because the firemen actually get a chance to operate the hydrants, get to see some, you know, they don't really know the location, every location, until they actually got to go there, right? And they're like, oh, I didn't realize there was another one right here around the corner, you know? And so it has a lot of, you know.
Nothing else, like you said, locating them. Yeah. Right half the battle.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. There's a lot of benefits to the program. Beth had already touched base on it. Our new office clerk, he's doing very well. I mean, he's very capable and, you know, he's very adaptable. He, of course, as you know, he did his internship here for college. So he picked the ball up and run with it. So it's good to see. It gives you know, them a little bit of relief to focus on other duties, which is great. We do have some in the plant here. There's some, that's the process piping back there is mostly all about 20 inch in diameter, all flanged, you know, pipe. We have some of it is starting to deteriorate on our backwash system. So we're gonna have to replace some of those, you know, 90 degree elbows, spool pieces, reducers, that type of stuff. A lot of the bolts on the flanges are now getting to a point where you gotta, you know, either replace them or do something. So we're gonna order the some of these pieces are custom made, you know, to make up the laying length. So we're gonna have to have our vendor order these spool, you know, manufacture these spool pieces, and then we'll have to have Coastal come in with his crew because it's gonna require, you know, overhead lifting with either, you know, I mean, these are big, you know, a 90 degree 20 inch. Flange pipe, that's a big heavy piece of equipment with, I think there's 25 bolts in each flange or something. I mean, big, you know, 1 inch diameter, 1 1/4 inch diameter. They're big heavy stuff. So we're gonna have to do a little bit of work over there over the winter, which is a good time. You know, it's inside work. The plant's not, you know, running at 100%, so that's good. And the last one is, if you guys haven't heard about it, we had a pretty significant water leak the end of November over here on East County, right where County and East County split.
You know about that?
No. I think the basement did, though.
Unbeknownst to me, that was a 6-inch AC pipe. I was always under the impression, all the records I have seen, it is either a 12-inch or a 10-inch cast iron pipe.
Same.
Harry's records show it as, I believe, a 10-inch cast iron pipe.
Yeah.
But lo and behold, it's a 6-inch AC pipe, or there's a section of AC. Yeah, 6-inch. Of course, as you know, especially down here in our 90-plus PSI area, once that AC pipe lets go, it's just complete, you know,
disaster.
It just completely disintegrates to nothing. So that was a lot of water. And of course, you're not too far from it. You know, required a pretty significant shutdown here at County Street. But I have to hand it, that was about a 10 p.m. call. I have to hand it to the road crew. I mean, you know, the foreman, he jumped right on it, and they mobilized almost immediately and got it under control and worked all night long. I don't think they got out of there till 10 in the morning. By the time they got, you know, it all dewatered and shut down and all that stuff. So, you know, hats off to those guys, because that was, you know, why everybody's sleeping, nobody realizes this stuff is happening. But until they open their faucet in the morning, it's a little discolored. Yes. Yes. So, you know, that's, but it's you know, I did the math on it. It's a lot of water that was lost. You know what I mean? Because our tanks were going down. Plus this place is, you know, kicking away at, you know, 2,500, 3,000 gallons a minute, and you know, you let that rip for a couple hours, it's a lot of water.
Yeah, that's a lot of water.
Chris, we talked a little bit about at the last meeting, but we had a high level alarm at the Pleasant Street Pump Station,
yeah,
which normally pumps 100, 100,000 gallons a day. I got called in that night around midnight, and when we looked at the total flows, we took in a quarter of a million gallons a day.
I believe it. I want to say it was over, I don't remember off the top of my head, but I believe it was over 2 million gallons that you could calculate of direct loss.
Yeah, really down.
Between tank level droppage, paint, you know, discharge rate from here.
Right. Yeah, really dirty water coming out, but really good water going.
Yeah. I mean, there's communities that don't even pump 2 million in a day, you know, and we lost in a matter of 3 hours, whatever it took to get the shutdown. So, you know, again, those guys deserve some recognition for understanding the situation doing the right thing and getting under control. So.
That's a tough leak. That's a lot of work.
Oh,
it was a lot of work.
Plus, like, say, dewater, how do you dewater them after get all that water in the trenches?
Yeah.
There's a culvert right on the side, so.
So we did, I think we had a sewer issue, right? Didn't we have somebody sue? Because the water was cascading into a sewer manhole.
Right.
Of course, overwhelmed, you know, the water, surface water is flowing towards Dighton. The sewage is flowing towards Harry to the other end of town, and of course the water that was making it in the manhole, the sewer manhole, was going into all the laterals that were nearby, and we had a couple houses that had, but I mean at that point it's pretty much all clear water.
Yeah, thank God.
But still you see the water
nobody
in your basement.
Nobody wants to see that.
Nobody wants to see that.
No.
So.
Hey, very good, Chris. Thank you very much.
What kind of leaky toilet stuff?
Yeah. Do we have any applications, any licenses? Oh, we do.
Yeah, I do.
Oh, just if you guys remember, we did talk part of phase two of that whole THM project, right, is the cleaning and lining, and now it's going to be direct replacement, right, of that pipeline up there. So that will be rectified, that AC pipe will be rectified in that project next year when they get that. I think it's, last I talked to Andrew, they were saying, I think April 23, they were planning on having 100% plans and ready for bid for that. So that will be, you know, not only do we want to do the cleaning and lining of the existing 10 inch, but now the replacement of that 6-inch AC. So that'll be in that project.
So we have to do this separately, right? Okay. So, Harry, you looked at these, right? MJD Excavating and Palmview Excavation?
Those are annual renewals, Steve. So, it's just they've been licensed previously and stuff like that. This is just their annual renewals, and we don't have any issues with either one of those contractors, so they're all set.
Okay. So, I make a motion we approve the license renewal for MJD Excavating.
Can you do a second?
Second.
Roll call vote.
Catterin, aye.
Bednarik, aye.
O'Brien, aye.
And then make a motion to approve Palmview Excavation.
Do a second?
Second.
Roll call vote.
Bednarik, aye.
Catterin, aye.
O'Brien, aye. They're in.
That's it.
No connections?
No.
Okay, do we have any topics not reasonably anticipated in 48 hours? I don't have anything.
Nope.
Okay. George, you got any questions? You usually have questions from the peanut gallery.
What school was the lead sample that was over the
Chase Street School?
Chase Street School. And it was just that one location in the school?
A faucet in the
cafeteria. So we collected two samples. One of them was that kitchen sink that exceeded the action level for lead.
Okay. And you tested all the other schools and you didn't find
any? So what the program is, we're required to sample at least two schools or early childhood development, daycare type facilities. I think we have a list of 18 total between schools and those types of facilities. What we did is we tried to, I think we went out for eight between three schools. I think it was three schools, George. We did three schools, and I think we did three childhood care facilities. This period, right, because we do these sampling events twice a year. So last period we did something similar.
So we alternate, it's not always the same.
Yeah, so what you basically do is whatever the oldest one was, is you'll put them on the hit list for the next round.
Okay. Anything else, George? That was easy today.
That was easy.
Okay, anybody else have anything else? No, motion to adjourn.
Second.
Aye.
All right. Have it done. Thank you. Nice.